The presence of a Russian attack submarine in Philippine waters is viewed with concern by President Marcos Jr., but national security experts believe the Russian sub posed no threat. Katrina Domingo reports.
This is the Russian submarine UFA-490 that was spotted 80 nautical miles off the coast of Cape Calavite in Occidental Mindoro last week. The Russian attack vessel traveled inside the Philippines' 200 nautical mile exclusive economic zone, but stayed outside the country's 12 nautical mile territorial sea. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. says this is still alarming and needs to be discussed with the armed forces.
We let the military discuss it with you.
All of that's
very concerning. Any intrusion into the West Philippine Sea of our AAC or of our base lines is very worrisome.
Several senators also flagged the incident and urged the Foreign Affairs Department to press Moscow for answers. Senate President Pro Tempore Jinggoy Estrada says the presence of a foreign military vessel in the area raises significant questions about the stability and security of the already volatile maritime domain and a known flashpoint for geopolitical tensions. Estrada says the Russians' unannounced entry into Philippine waters increases the risk of misunderstandings and conflicts in the already sensitive region. For Senate Special Committee on Philippine Maritime and Admiralty Zones Chairperson Francis Tolentino, aside from diplomatic inquiries, the DFA should also tell the international community about the Philippines' serious efforts to consolidate its claim and jurisdiction over its maritime zones and territorial waters. National Security Council Assistant Director General Jonathan Malaya says the armed forces immediately deployed planes and a frigate to monitor the location and activities of the Russian submarine while it was inside the Philippines EEZ. Malaya, however, notes the Russian sub was merely passing through.
We challenged the attack submarine kung ano ang ginagawa niya sa ating exclusive economic zone. Nagpakilala siya at sinabi niya na galing siya ng exercises, PASEX exercises with the Royal Malaysian Navy sa Kota Kinabalu sa Malaysia, and on the way niya siya pabalik sa kanyang naval base sa Vladivostok. Sinabi niya na inaantay lang niya na gumanda yung panahon. Ano kaya siya nag-surface, no? At ipapaalam niya sa atin pag ready na siyang bumalik sa Russia, no, sa Vladivostok. And eventually, nung kinahapunan, ay nagpaalam din siya. Sabi niya ay babalik na siya sa Russia. Okay.
Malaya adds the Russian submarine coordinated with the Philippine Navy to guarantee that it was not involved in any actions that violate the Philippines' rights to these waters.
So technically, the Russian ship is exercising freedom of navigation. So very clearly, nakalagay din sa ating mga batas kasama yung Philippine Maritime Zones Law na itong exclusive economic zone, ang karapatan natin dyan is more of economic. Kahit sinong barko ay pwedeng dumaan dyan, so long as hindi siya naglo-loiter or hindi siya kumukuha ng mga natural resources, o kaya naman meron siyang ibang ginagawa na hindi tama, no? Gaya ng paggawa, for example, ng Marine Scientific Survey.
Tolentino praised the Philippine Navy for its quick response and for consistently shadowing the submarine until the foreign vessel finally exited Philippine waters. The Foreign Affairs Department has yet to issue a statement on the matter. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
Filipino fishermen are harassed by the Chinese Coast Guard while en route to the Rozul Reef in the West Philippine Sea. The details from Bianca Dava.
On November 28, the Philippine Coast Guard received information that a People's Liberation Army Navy helicopter was harassing Filipino fishermen in Iroquois Arrozal Reef. This video was taken by one of the fishermen.
Ang isang PLA Navy helicopter with tail number 65 na hinaharas ang ating mga mangisdang. Ang ginawa na itong helicopter na ito, nag-hover siya ng mababang lipad lamang at 15 feet. At ginagawa niya ito sa mga mangisdang Pilipino. We're thinking that they're doing this as a form of harassment para itaboy ang ating mga mangisdang Pilipino.
The incident prompted the PCG to deploy the BRP Melchora Aquino and the BRP Cape Engaño to check on the affected fishermen. ABS-CBN News was among the team of journalists who joined the mission. The PCG vessels reached the vicinity of Escuadra or Sabina Shoal in the dead of night on Saturday. But poor visibility did not stop the CCG vessel with bow number 5203 from sailing dangerously close to the Philippine vessel. At one point, the Chinese Coast Guard ship even cut off the path of BRP Cape Enganyo.
They don't respect the collision regulation. They also think na ang presensya nila dito ay lehitimong maritime law enforcement. But in reality, alam naman natin, no? In the middle of the night, you're going to cut a particular vessel. No? This is very dangerous. Maaaring magdulot ito ng banggaan at maging resulta ng isang sakunan. But our Philippine Coast Guard commanding officers are always professional and very competent, no, in terms of seamanship skills. Kung kaya we were able to prevent this kind of collision with the Chinese Coast Guard.
The CCG followed us until we reached the vicinity of Rosal Reef early Sunday morning. Iroquois Reef or Rosal Reef is 128 nautical miles or 237 kilometers away from mainland Palawan. It is well within the country's 200 nautical mile exclusive economic zone. But even here, we can still see the presence of Chinese vessels. In fact, this China Coast Guard vessel has been following and observing the Philippine Coast Guard's operations here in the area. Around 20 Filipino fishing boats were seen in the reef. PCG spokesperson for the West Philippine Sea, Commodore J. Tarjala, said two fishing boats were destroyed by bad weather on Saturday, a day before the PCG arrived in the area. He expressed a disappointment after the CCG did not extend any help to the Filipino fishermen who were in distress.
All of the crew were rescued by other Filipino fishing boats. So wala namang nasawi or nawala. It is also very disappointing, no? At nakakalungkot talaga na inilahad din ng ating mga maisdang Pilipino na despite of the presence of China Coast Guard Vessel 5205 at ang nagmumonitor ng mga PLA Navy nung mga panahon na lumulubog itong dalawang bangka ng ating mga kababayang Pilipino, ay hindi sila nag-offer ng kahit na anumang assistance. No?
The CCG deployed two of its rigid hull inflatable boats after BRP Melchora Aquino launched its RIB to transport some of the fishermen from their boats to the BRP Cape Enganyo. Boat Captain Arnel Marceliana said their group left Quezon, Palawan on November 25 and arrived in Rosal Reef 2 days later. The CCG tried to block them from reaching the area.
Punta namin ito na nangawil kami. Hindi kami masyadong makaporma kay dito man sila lagi nakaabang, nagabantay. Hindi niya rin masyadong malapit kasi malapit na kami sa Baura. Hindi rin sila makalapit ng gusto. Kung magharang sila, hindi mo makasaya sa matin dyan. Kasi ibang salita nila. Nagkasinyas na sila na magbalik. Sabi nila, back to Philippines daw.
Rosal Reef is a known haven for different species of fish and marine life, making it a perfect fishing spot. However, the constant presence of the CCG is making it difficult for Filipino fisherfolk to safely reach and stay in this area. The Filipino fishers have also attempted several times to enter Escoda Shoal, but they would face the same harassment from the Chinese Coast Guard.
Sana po mapaalis nila yung kondito, ma'am, itong nangaharang sa amin po, ma'am, ba? Para makapangisda po kami, kawawa naman po kami, mangingisda. Halos hindi na kami makakuha ng pamalakaya namin kasi inaharang nila kami. Halos kulang na lang bungguin po kami.
Despite these challenges, Tarjala is encouraging more Filipino fishermen to cast their nets in Rosal Reef as Philippine Maritime Forces continuously maintain presence in the area.
The Chinese are going to hesitate harassing our Filipino fishermen kapag merong Philippine Coast Guard vessel or any Philippine Maritime Forces na nandito sa West Philippine Sea. The confidence of the Filipino fishermen has tremendously increased for the past 2 years already dahil alam nila na ang pamahalaan na to under President Marcos has been very firm in standing up for our rights in the West Philippine Sea.
Meanwhile, the PCG also distributed Christmas food packs and drinking water to the Filipino fishers. Fishermen are hopeful that one day they will be able to fish freely and safely in the West Philippine Sea. Bianca Dava, ABS-CBN News, West Philippine Sea.
A coalition of various groups files an impeachment complaint against Philippine Vice President Sara Duterte. The complaint was filed Monday despite an earlier appeal by President Marcos Jr. for House lawmakers not to pursue Duterte's impeachment. Vivian Gulia has tonight's top story.
Sana po sa pamamagitan ng complaint na ito, maisara na natin yung bangungot na dulot ng ating pong Vice President sa taong bayan.
16 individuals from different groups signed as complainants in the first ever impeachment complaint filed against Vice President Sara Duterte before the House of Representatives. These include the presidential advisor on the peace process of former President Benigno Aquino III, Teresita Deles, former Magdalo Representative Gary Alejano, priests Flavie Villanueva and Robert Reyes, and a relative of Kian de los Santos, who was killed in the Duterte administration's drug war. Akbayan Party List Representative Percival Sendanya endorsed the impeachment complaint, which has 24 articles of impeachment. Among the grounds cited are the alleged culpable violation of the Constitution, alleged bribery and illegal accumulation of wealth, and the alleged graft and corruption involving the confidential funds in the offices led by Vice President Duterte, including the 125 million pesos disbursed in December 2022.
They were also respondent and members of her family engaged also in bribery and or in the unexplained receipt of hundreds of millions of funds from known drug personalities.
Duterte's alleged betrayal of public trust and other alleged high crimes were also cited as grounds after the vice president claimed she contacted an assassin to kill President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., First Lady Liza Araneta Marcos, and House Speaker Martin Romualdez if the alleged plot against her succeeds.
Because these are very unbecoming, and these are actually betrayal of public trust, because these are also high crimes, yung kanyang mga threats doon sa latest na mga rant niya o kanyang mga meltdown. The complainants also cited as among the articles of impeachment, the respondents' acts of cuddling, defending, and otherwise acting as an enabler of Pastor Apollo Kibuloy.
House Secretary General Reginald Velasco received the impeachment complaint at around 4:30 p.m. and gave assurances the lower chamber will proceed with its duties on the matter, even after the president discouraged the ouster move in a text message to House allies.
Addressing an impeachment complaint is not a discretionary act for the House of Representatives, but a constitutional obligation. The House of Representatives remains committed to conducting the proceedings with transparency, impartiality, and full respect for the rule of law.
Some lawmakers said they did not receive the president's text message, but they perceived it as just an advice and not an order.
Siyempre, pakikinggan din naman natin yung sasabihin ng presidente. But we'll also have to check kung ano man yung ifa-file nila.
We know naman from his statement, it's actually a plea. No, it's advice. He's not really trying to tell the legislative what to do. This is a constitutional mandate po, no? Nasa constitution natin yung process of impeachment.
A Solon who confirmed that her chief of staff received the message from the office of the president said she agrees with the chief executive.
I felt, well, honestly, relief because I agree with it, as I said. Pagdating dun po sa statement ni President na he would rather that no impeachment move be filed, ano? I think this is acting like the father of our country.
Under the 1987 Constitution and the House rules, if a verified complaint resolution is filed by at least one-third of all House members, the House plenary can endorse it to the Senate. But since the impeachment complaint against the VP is endorsed by only one congressman, it will have to go through the House Committee on Justice, which will determine its sufficiency in form and substance, as well as hold public hearings and evidence review. The House Speaker has a maximum of 10 session days from receipt of a verified impeachment complaint to include it in the order of business, and another 3 session days to refer it to the House Committee on Justice. The committee will have maximum of 60 session days from referral to submit its findings and recommendations to the House plenary, which will be calendared for consideration by the House within 10 session days from receipt. Including today, the lower house has theoretically 9 session days until December 18th before it goes on break. It will resume session on January 13th until February 7th. But Sendanya is not losing hope.
Kung hindi ngayon, kailan pa? Kapag gusto, may paraan. At yung paraan po na yon ay paraan para panagutin ang mga nang-aabuso sa kapangyarihan at ninanakawan ng taong bayan. Naniniwala tayo na matindi yung merits ng ating impeachment complaint.
At the House plenary, a vote of at least one-third of all House members is necessary to endorse the resolution setting forth the articles of impeachment to the Senate. At the Senate, a favorable vote of at least two-thirds of all its members is needed to convict. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
The National Bureau of Investigation subpoenas Philippine Vice President Duterte to submit herself for questioning on December 11th. The NBI wants the Vice President to explain her supposed death threat against the first couple and the House Speaker. It also summoned persons who organized the online press conference in which she disclosed her supposed assassination plot. The Vice President was initially summoned to appear at the NBI last Friday, but she asked that it be postponed due to a scheduling conflict. The NBI warns it may file charges against the Vice President if she remains uncooperative.
Kung dumating ang December 11 and wala ni ha ni ho, walang pasabi, walang abogado na pinadala, then we will proceed po with our report and our investigation. Miss Vice President naman, hindi namin mapipersang sabihin sa amin kung sino man yung kausap niyang tao. Kung hindi niya gusto i-identify kung sino yung kausap niya, eh, so be it. Pero nag-iimbestiga po kami from other sources kung sino po yung kausap niya. Lahat ng circumstances ikukonsider namin bago kami makapag-conclude kung ano bang kaso, kung meron bang kaso na isasampa laban sa Vice President.
A Philippine congresswoman claps back at Vice President Duterte's claim that she would have been a sure winner if she ran for president in 2022. Taguig Representative Amparo Zamora sees no reason for the Vice President to make such a claim now. The Vice President earlier refuted allegations that she's in a hurry to replace President Marcos Jr. She said she did not seek the presidency in 2022, despite all supposed indications that she would surely win the post.
Then why didn't she run? If she had it in the bag, she should have... Dapat tumakbo siya. You know... I mean, 2025 na eh. 20, di ba? Ngayon mo pa sasabihin yan. Di sana tumakbo siya. Tsaka yung presidency, kita naman nating lahat sa history, destiny yan. Eh, sorry. Kasi di ba, I mean, what was that statement for? Then she should have filed to be president, to run for president, but she didn't. She filed to run for vice president and now she's our vice president. So that's what it is.
The Philippine National Police says it sees no credible threat to Vice President Duterte. The vice president had previously accused the government of ignoring well-documented threats to her life. Police spokesperson Brigadier General Gene Fajardo says the PNP remains vigilant and focused on providing ample security to the vice president. A block of Philippine congressmen supports a call to investigate bloggers and internet trolls for allegedly spreading fake news about the joint panel that's probing the alleged misuse of the vice president's confidential funds. The so-called young guns in the lower house underscore the importance of fighting organized and online disinformation campaigns. Party List Representative Raj Gutierrez says the constitutional protection for freedom of speech must be tempered with responsible practice and use. House Assistant Majority Leader Zia Alonto Adyong says disinformation about the Quad Committee has led to anonymous death threats to congressmen and their families. The Quad Committee's overall chair, Surigao del Norte Congressman Ace Barbers, had called for the probe of online attacks against him. Barber cited the adverse impact of troll campaigns on House probers. A court in the Philippine province of Tarlac sets on Thursday the arraignment of dismissed Mayor Alice Guo for her material misrepresentation case. The case filed by the Election Commission accuses Guo of having misrepresented herself as a Filipino when she filed her candidacy for Banban Town Mayor in 2022. The National Bureau of Investigation later discovered that Guo was actually a Chinese citizen named Guo Huaping. The Philippine Supreme Court reschedules oral arguments on the controversial transfer of PhilHealth's reserve fund to the National Treasury. It moved the hearings from January 14 to February 4. The High Court did not explain the delay. The tribunal had issued a temporary restraining order in October to prohibit the further transfer of PhilHealth funds to government coffers. The TRO was sought by the Isambayan Coalition and two separate groups led by Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel and Bayan Muna Chairman Nery Colmenares. They are seeking a halt to what they say is the illegal transfer of 89.9 billion pesos of supposed excess funds of the state insurer. Severe weather in the Philippine Bicol region leaves several people dead. The fatalities were reported after a shear line triggered heavy rains and floods over the weekend. At least three people died in separate drowning incidents in Camarines Sur. Two other fatalities of storm-related accidents were reported in Camarines Norte. The Civil Defense Office says around 226 families across the Bicol region have been displaced by the severe weather. Incessant rains also affected parts of the Visayas region. Residents of Bataan Aklan had to navigate chest-deep floods. Two landslides were reported in Cebu City. Rescue operations are underway in Rojas City.